Namaste viewers, in this video clipping we will discuss the income and employment theory, the excess demand and deficient demand concepts. So you have already understood through previous clippings that the aggregate demand in the economy can be in excess of the full employment, or the aggregate demand can be deficient of the full employment equilibrium. So what is this excess demand? It's a situation when the aggregate demand is more than the aggregate supply corresponding to full employment level of output in the economy. Let me repeat. Excess demand is a situation when aggregate demand is more than the aggregate supply corresponding to the full employment level of output in the economy. So that could be creating an inflationary gap or an increase in the price level. Now think of it, when demand is more in the economy compared to that of the supply, definitely there will be an increase in the price, right? Even in a micro market, a market for products, when demand for something, that is a product, is going to be more than that of the supply, will the price not be high? Simply the same. So in the economy also, when aggregate demand or the planned expenditure is going to be more than the income, that could lead to an inflationary gap. So the gap between the full employment AD and that of the actual AD, is what is the inflationary gap. To be very clear, inflationary gap refers to the gap by which the actual AD exceeds the aggregate demand required to establish full employment in the economy, right? So what will that mean? That could mean that there is no idle capacity in the economy. There is an overfull employment, or all the resources are completely employed. There will be no involuntary unemployment in the economy. So what does all this mean? So through diagrams and through various other concepts, we'll try and understand more about this. So look at this clipping. This slide actually, it shows to you the full employment equilibrium, which is at E, right? So if OM is what is the full employment level of output, corresponding to this full employment level of output, the AD is equal to AS. So that is the full employment equilibrium that is attained at E. Now what actually is there in the economy is AD1, right? So that AD1 or the actual AD is in excess of the full employment AD, or corresponding to the level of full employment, AD1 is greater than the full employment AD, fine? So this gap FE in the diagram, the vertical distance between AD1 and AD, this gap, right, that gives you the inflationary gap, right? So that is the inflationary gap in the economy. Now what did we see? We saw that, look at this, inflationary gap refers to the gap by which the actual AD exceeds the aggregate demand required to establish full employment in the economy. That is, corresponding to the full employment level, if the actual AD is going to exceed the full employment AD, that is the inflationary gap, right? So this is what is shown in this particular diagram. If this AD is a full employment AD, corresponding to this full employment level of output, in the economy, the actual AD exceeds the full employment AD corresponding to this full employment level. As a result, you see that there is a gap to the extent of FE. So that gap is an inflationary gap. Fine? That gap is an inflationary gap. Right? And why do we say that there is involuntary unemployment being absent here? Because already the economy is working at full employment. Corresponding to that level, the actual AD is more than the full employment AD. And you know that at full employment, there is absence of involuntary unemployment, isn't it? Yeah, that's what you saw in some of the previous videos, that corresponding to the full employment, there will be absence of involuntary unemployment, right? Now, let me go back to the first slide and show you the last bit. Yeah, this is what we discussed here. There will be no involuntary unemployment. Further, no idle capacity in the economy. What is this idle capacity? There is unused capacity. There won't be any idle capacity or unused capacity in the economy. Because once more, let me repeat. Here, in this diagram, what is shown is the full employment level of output, and corresponding to this full employment level of output, there is going to be an excess demand or an excess aggregate demand compared to the aggregate demand at full employment. And so then when there is already full employment, where is unused capacity? No unused capacity, right? Resources are fully already employed. So what does this situation mean? This situation means that the aggregate demand is in excess of the aggregate demand that is supposed to give you the full employment output. Fine. So to actually repeat as per the theory, let me move once more back to the previous slide. Look at this. Excess demand. It refers to a situation when AD is more than AS, corresponding to full employment level of output in the economy. Right? That is, inflationary gap refers to a gap by which the actual AD exceeds the aggregate demand required to establish the full employment in the economy. And what more you have understood? There will be no idle capacity because already the economy is working at full employment. And also, there won't be any involuntary unemployment because, you know, full employment is a situation where there will be absence of involuntary unemployment. Okay? So, that is the detail that you will have to know from this diagram. Right? Now, what causes this kind of excess demand in an economy? Right? The excess demand, otherwise known as the overfull demand, or this inflationary gap that is caused due to the excess demand. Why does it happen? It happens because of variety of reasons. So over here, this equation, it gives you the various components of aggregate demand. In the very first video clipping or the very first concept under this particular unit, you have understood the aggregate demand components. Aggregate demand in a four-sector economy is nothing but C plus I plus G plus X minus M. The private final consumption, the investment expenditure, government expenditure, and net exports. So, an increase in the propensity to consume or increase in the private consumption will increase the AD. When C increases, right, definitely the AD will increase. So, you know, when propensity to consume increases, C increases, right? So when C increases, AD will increase. What more? You've also understood when the disposable income increases, the consumption will increase. Yeah, disposable income is the amount of income that the economy might have with it to spend on consumption. Right? That is, after payment of taxes, whatever income is left with them to dispose of is what is the disposable income. Right? So that means when the government decides to reduce the tax, that would give more of disposable income in the hands of the people. Taxes are going down. So the economy will have a lot of money due to this. Disposable income will be high, right? Small amount of taxes paid. So the amount of money left with the population will be a large amount, and that they can happily spend on consumption. So that's what they will do. So reduction in the taxes will increase the consumption expenditure, and once more AD will be high. Then increase in government expenditure, right? That could happen due to a government policy. You know that government undertakes variety of consumption and capital expenditures. That is, they buy variety of consumption goods and capital goods. So if they decide to increase the spending, naturally G will go up, and that will cause AD also to go up. Then increase in investment. Once more, we talk about the government policy to spend more on the autonomous investment. There is all welfare activities increased, infrastructural development going up, construction increasing, and then road building, all that is increasing. So that would create employment, right? That naturally will increase spending. So when investment increases, as such, C plus I is going to increase, AD will increase. All the more so when investment increases, probably in the long run also there is a scope for more spending. So increase in investment, first of all over here, directly increases the AD. Then fall in the imports. Now that could happen due to change in the trade policy, right? Now if there is going to be a favorable trade policy for importing, import will increase. But here the situation is fall in the import. So that means maybe the trade policy is against importing, which is going to make import costly. So maybe import becoming costly, people will reduce the import. So when there is going to be fall in the import, you see that this is minus M here, right? So this minus component goes down, naturally AD will increase. Then rise in exports, right? Now both exports and imports will be affected by the local prices also, right? Now when will the economy be able to increase exports, right? When the locally produced goods are cheaper, fine. That is when the local price level is low. Yeah, when the local price level is low, that would mean that the locally produced products are sold at a competitive price. So definitely that will increase the scope to sell in the international market. So that will increase the exports, right? Same thing works here also. When the locally produced goods are available cheaper, why will population import? They won't import, right? So the domestic price level affects both these components. Also the trade policy of the nation will affect these two components. So because of change in the exports and imports, the AD will change. So increase in export, fall in the import, that will increase the AD. Then there could be this deficit financing also. What is deficit financing? Deficit financing is normally undertaken by the RBI on the direction of the government. It is a method through which there is fresh currency printed. So when fresh currency is going to be printed and circulated in the economy, that will increase the money supply in the economy, that will give more purchasing power to the population. So probably the population will purchase more. Fine. So when deficit financing is going to be undertaken, so then the spending will become high. So naturally the aggregate demand will become high. Right. So because of the various components of the aggregate demand, there is a chance of the aggregate demand becoming an excess aggregate demand. Right. So these are the reasons for excess demand in an economy. Now, what happens actually because of this excess demand? What is the impact of excess demand? Impact on the output, impact on the employment will be nil, no effect, right? Already full employment output, right? Beyond that, how can output increase? It cannot increase, right? Beyond that, it cannot increase because obviously there are no resources. Already all resources are fully employed. So where will the government go for some more resources? So there won't be any effect on the output. Also, there won't be any effect on the employment. Already full employment, correct? Already full employment, so there won't be any change in the employment or in the output. Both of them will not be affected by the excess demand, right? But then there will be increase in the general price level. You've already understood that an excess of aggregate demand corresponding to the full employment aggregate demand will lead to an inflationary gap. There will be an increase in the general price level in the economy, right? Now, Keynes comes up with an alternate solution to this particular problem. If the economy uses up all the resources, does it mean there is no scope for the economy to develop at all? Definitely not. Now, I should remind you of this concept of voluntary unemployment and involuntary unemployment. Now, full employment is defined as a situation where there is absence of involuntary unemployment. But what about voluntary unemployment? That will still be there, right? That's why Keynes says that no economy ideally is, you know, fully employed in the right sense like the classical economists, and there is always this so-called natural rate of unemployment because voluntarily so many people might be unemployed. So now this is the area where the government has to concentrate on, right? So by offering higher wage level, probably they can tend to attract these voluntarily unemployed lot, and they might try and provide more wages, right? By providing more wages, the voluntary unemployed lot probably will be induced to work, right? At the prevailing wage rate, they refuse to work. But if the wage rate is going to increase, probably that is going to be good for them. They will think twice about staying at home. They may start thinking about offering their labor too. So maybe slowly the voluntarily unemployed lot will become the workforce. They will be available for working now. So that could be growth of resource or some sort of natural resource which is found out, some improvement in the capital resource. So when there is going to be growth of resource, right, then probably there is a possibility of the economy growing or developing, and that is how it happens. Fine. So all those things apart, simply coming back to this particular theory, as per the basic theory, the effect of excess demand on the output and on the employment will be nil. No change in the level of output because already there is a full employment output, right? And no change in the level of employment because already there is a full employment, right? So what will happen to the price level? Only the price level will increase. So there will be an inflationary gap because of this excess demand, right? Okay. So what is this deficient demand then? Deficient demand is a situation when the aggregate demand is less than the aggregate supply corresponding to the full employment level of output in the economy, right? Now, what happens? Again, once more, we will see the diagrammatic representation of this particular concept, right? Yeah, see, look at this. OM is the level of full employment output, and corresponding to that, you have this AS equal to AD, so that is a full employment equilibrium. Now, what actually is happening in the economy is this AD, which is deficient, right? So AD is deficient, or which is below the full employment level of AD. Yeah, corresponding to the full employment ADAS, right? You have a deficient demand to the extent of EG, the demand is falling short, right? Now, because of this, the new equilibrium will be attained on, at this point F, on the AD1, which is lower than the full employment AD. Yeah, this is the actual AD, AD1. So on the actual AD, the AS will become equal at point F, right? So if you draw a, you know, a vertical line connecting the x-axis, you will understand that to some extent there will be a underutilization, right? So you just draw a vertical line connecting the x-axis, so you will understand that there will be underemployment of resources or underutilization of resources, right? Also the output will be at a lower level, right? At F compared to this, there will be a lower level of output, isn't it? So to some extent the resources will not be fully utilized, right? Now this is what you see in this previous slide. I showed you this one. Now let's move on to the next paragraph in the deficient demand slide. Deflationary gap is a gap by which the actual AD falls short of the AD required to establish the full employment AD. Yeah, so let's again get back to the diagram. So we get back to the diagram, then you will understand that there is a shortage in the AD. Yes, so corresponding to the full employment level, the AD1 is short of this full employment AD, right? And this gap, that is what is the deflationary gap, right? Okay, so let's see that once more. Deflationary gap is a gap by which the actual AD falls short of the AD required to establish the full employment AD. And there is definitely an underutilization of resource. Also, there will be involuntary unemployment. So how do you show that? See, this is what I told you. Corresponding to this new equilibrium, if you draw a vertical down there to the x-axis, so to some extent, there will be an underutilization or underemployment. Yeah, so deficient demand leads to not only a deflation gap, but will also lead to underemployment and underutilization of resources. Fine? Right, yeah, this is it. Impact of the deficient demand. Deficient demand, the effect on the output is such that there will be stockpiling. Yeah, see, deficient demand, right? That means demand is not coming up in the economy for a variety of products and services. So what will happen to the production units? They will be stuck with a stock. Stock is going to pile up. So what will they do then? Will they take a risk and produce more? No. They're already sitting on a huge stock. So they will not take up the risk of producing more. So that means they will cut down on the future production. So there will be a fall in the planned output. So that's why you see there is an underemployment equilibrium. Right? Output will fall. To the left of the full employment equilibrium, the economy will achieve its new equilibrium, right? So if you see that in the diagram, then you will understand. I'm trying to get back to this diagram slide. Yeah, no, this is the remedy. Okay, so fine, it's just from the beginning we will just see income and employment, excess demand, reasons, all this we saw. Yeah, this is the diagram. I got that. Okay, so look at this. So there will be an underemployment of resource and there will be a lower output, lower level of output. Fine, so that's the effect there. So what is the effect of the deficient demand? The deficient demand might be causing a stockpiling, a fall in the planned output, and then there could be involuntary unemployment. Then there could be the general price level which is going down. There could be a deflation shown, right? Or a deflationary gap is what is found. Okay, now what causes this? Reasons for deficient demand. Again, AD, you know, it is C plus I plus G plus X minus M, right? So reasons for excess demand you saw. Similar reasons here, the components will be affecting the aggregate demand. So obviously, decrease in propensity to consume, decrease in C will decrease AD. Low consumption, low AD, right? And increase in tax, that will result in lower disposable income. So in turn, population will spend less on consumption, right? Increase in tax will leave a small disposable income. So spending on consumption will become small and thereby AD will be low. When government decides to spend less, G falls, this will fall. Fall in the investment, fine, I falls, this again will fall. Then increase in imports, yeah, minus M, right? So if import increases, this will fall. Fall in the exports, if export is going to fall, again AD will fall. Now factors, these factors, C, I, G, X, M, all these, you know what factors affect them in turn, right? We just spoke that in the excess aggregate demand. So I'm not delaying further there. Yeah, so that is the reason for the deficient demand. Also, you saw the effect of deficient demand, right? This is the diagram that you saw that depicts the deficient demand, right? Okay, this is the impact that you saw for deficient demand, right? So with this, I end this clipping. Now in the next clipping, probably you will see the difference between excess demand and deficient demand and few more concepts. Keep watching. Namaste.